Good evening and welcome to Monday Night Bible Study. My name is Pastor Jeremy and it is a joy to be with you tonight. Thank you for tuning in. It is always a pleasure to have you tune into something that's happening at Lakewood Church. And of course, every Monday night we have something great for you, but every time we meet, we have something great for you. If you ever get a chance to come through Houston, we would love to have you here in the building with us for a Sunday, a weekend service, maybe English service or Spanish service in the afternoon. So from wherever you're watching in the world, thank you. Put it in the chat from wherever you're watching. If you're in another country, if you're in another state, if you're in another city here in the United States or anywhere around the world, put it in the chat where you're watching from, and we would love to celebrate all of us as the extended community of Lakewood Church. And that's what we consider you, our extended family here at Lakewood. And it's always a joy to be able to come together, to open up God's Word, to explore the Scriptures more, and to have an opportunity to really grow. We don't want information. I know information is important. I like it. I hope that you like it as well. But our ultimate goal is transformation. We want to be changed. And tonight we get the opportunity to see one more time in the Scriptures how God empowers, changes us, and equips us for our calling in this world. God has created you and I for a purpose. He's created me for a purpose. He's created you from the womb. He's created you for a purpose. And so tonight we want to understand what God is doing in us and through us. If you want to follow along with everything going on at Monday Night Bible Study, you're welcome to do that. You can text Bible Study, two words put together, Bible Study to 77377 with your cell phone, or you can email us if you want to correspond, if you have questions, if you want to ask anything that we've taught on a Monday night, if you want to ask any questions about currently the series that we're in on the book of John, you're welcome to do that. Or any past teaching that we've done, you're welcome to do that. We would love to correspond with you. BibleStudy@lakewood.cc, BibleStudy@lakewood.cc if you'd like to email us. Before we get started tonight, we are in the book of John. So if you have your Bible, I would encourage you to pull it out, whether you pull out a digital or a physical Bible like I have. Pull it out and we'll get into the book of John, the end of chapter 6. But before we do that, I would love to pray. The Bible says that when we pray, God hears us and He bends His ear to listen. And so whatever's going on in your world right now, let's take it to the Father. The Bible says that He cares for us. He cares about all the details of our life. He cares about what's happening in your world right now, whether it's a relationship, finances, school, your career, a child, whatever it may be. Let's take that, lay it at the feet of Jesus and let him take it. Because our cares and concerns, many times the Bible says, can choke out the word that God is trying to speak to us. So we don't want that to happen. We don't want to allow the worries and concerns of this life to be louder than faith in God. So tonight, let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you that you care for us. And I pray for every single person watching, whatever's going on in their world, Father, whether it be finances, whether it be job, career, whether it be health, I pray healing over anybody watching, for a child. If we have a family member who's not following you and they're off course, Father, I pray that you draw them back to you. For any of us who need guidance, for any of us in school who feel overwhelmed, give us peace. And Father, we thank you that you care for us in every way and you're working behind the scenes, even when we don't see it, you're working on our behalf because you love us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, we are continuing the series in the book of John. We are in the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, four Gospels. And we're continuing in John, which is the fourth Gospel. And we're going to start in verse 60 of John chapter 6. I'm going to give you a moment to turn there. But we'll be in John chapter 6, verse 60, and I'm going to go through the chapter of John 7. We're not going to go over every verse, too many verses to go line by line. But I'm going to give us a big picture view of what the gospel writer, the author, John, the follower of Jesus, what he is trying to communicate to us about Jesus. The book of John is about the life of Jesus. And it's about the fact that Jesus is the source of all life. So the book of John was written, the gospel, the pronouncement. When we say gospel, what do we mean? It just simply means the gospel is the royal announcement that Jesus is king. And because he is king, we can be brought into the kingdom. We can be brought into the family of believers by faith. And whether you've put your faith in Jesus yet or not, we'll talk about how Jesus is the source of all life. And that's what John is trying to communicate. So tonight, before we even get started, I would love for you to do something. In the chat, would you write, if you're a follower of Jesus, would you write in the chat how Jesus has been a source of life for you over the last week, month, year, or decade? Would you write in the chat, here's how Jesus has been a source of life for me. For all of us, it may be different. At every moment in life, it may be, he's a source of peace. He's a source of provision. He's a source of joy. He's a source of confidence. How has he been a source of life for you? Ultimately, Jesus is the source of all physical and spiritual life, but he's also the source of everything spiritually that is produced in us. So if we use a word called shalom, which is a Hebrew word for really wholeness and peace, but it's more than that. It's really in every area of our life, Jesus is the fullness of what we need. He is the great I am. He is God. He is who we need when we need him to be it. That's what it means to be the source of life. And what John is doing is John's trying to communicate to us how Jesus is the source of life. So we're going to go through tonight, put it in the chat, and then we'll talk about what John is trying to communicate about the source of life. Tonight, the book of John is not a synoptic gospel. That's a big word. It just simply means there's four gospels. Matthew, Mark, and Luke sort of play off of one another. Matthew, Mark, and Luke use one another as a source of inspiration to explain the life of Jesus. But John is the one that really doesn't use the other three as his source. He really uses his own experience with Jesus to write his gospel. And the book of John, the gospel, is really, it's a book that really explains the spiritual nature of who Jesus is. Matthew, Mark, and Luke talk about his kingship, talk about his humanity. They talk about his physical life in many ways. They explain his miracles, 37 miracles he did, including 33 healings. But John really explains the spiritual aspect of who Jesus is. So as we go through this, let's put on our lens, our glasses, that we see Jesus spiritually and the power by which Jesus, we live this life through his power, and the power that is in us comes out. And that's really what I want to focus on tonight. The last part of John 6 and the entirety of John chapter 7 is the fact that because of Jesus, you and I have resurrection life, the same resurrection that he was raised, we will eventually. And then right now we have that power living inside of us and it's coming out of us in every way in life. And so I want to encourage you tonight as a believer, as somebody by faith, not by your own works, because we can't boast in our own works. We are not saved by our own works. We're only saved by the life of Jesus and his death and resurrection. But because of that, the power of God, Romans 8:11, lives on the inside of us and it comes out. We're going to see tonight how the imagery of water and a river shows us that we have life coming from us. The book of John is set up like a tabernacle or a temple. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel, God instructed them to have a place of worship where heaven and earth came together. In the ancient world, gods were known for setting up temples and then putting their image in it. And it was where they would meet with humans. And the God of the Bible, Yahweh, had his people, the Israelites, set up a tabernacle and a temple to be a place where he met with them. Originally, it was the garden, but Adam and Eve were removed from the garden because of sin. But then God decided, you know what, I'm gonna meet with human beings in a temple. And so, when Jesus came, the earthly temple, the concrete building, was just a shadow of what was to come. It was just a billboard pointing to something else that was actually the true substance of life. So where the temple, where the Jews believed, the Israelites believed, they could go and meet with God and find life through the temple, through sacrifices and offerings, and through Torah, which was the law, the first five books of the Bible, they now find life in Jesus. Jesus came, and this is what John is explaining to us, Jesus came to be the actual temple. He is where heaven and earth came together when he was walking the earth. And so where the Israelites would originally go for forgiveness to the temple, they now came to Jesus for forgiveness. And this was a radical thought, because if he is, and he is God in flesh, Philippians chapter 2 says, Jesus is God in flesh. You could come to him for forgiveness now. You could come to him for life now. You didn't go to the temple. You didn't go to Torah or the law to find life. You find life in Jesus. So Jesus, as the person, as God in flesh, was the actual temple that the Bible wanted to see all along. The concrete temple that God had the children of Israel set up until Jesus came was just a holding place for where heaven and earth came together. Now it's in Jesus. So we see that the book of John is written that we would believe in Jesus, that we would believe. In fact, John says that, I write this book so that you would believe in Jesus, that you would put your faith in him, because he is the source of all life. He is God in the flesh, and he is the one who forgives and saves, and he is the one who redeems. He is the one who heals. He is the one who calls. He is the one who strengthens and empowers us in this world and for eternity. So the emphasis of John is that we have been joined to Jesus. He is the temple that we go to now for everything. We've been joined to him. And so because of that, his life, he lives in us. The Bible has this interesting, it uses an interesting metaphor to say, if you believe, if you've put your faith in Jesus, he now lives inside of you. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is the Spirit of Jesus. Jesus sent the Holy Spirit to us after he died and rose again and then ascended to heaven. He lives inside of us. There was an ancient Chinese philosopher that was asked one time, what's most unique about all the different world religions and philosophies? And he said, the most unique one is Christianity. He said, it's the only religious system, or it's the only faith system that I've ever seen where the God of its people comes to live inside of its followers, where God comes to live inside of us. And this is what we see in John 7. The entire book, this is the life of Jesus. He is the source of all life, and he lives inside of us. He is the true temple, and out of us comes his power. And we're going to see that in this chapter. But the reason I say that the book of John is laid out like a temple is because in the temple, you had three main areas. You had the outer court, the inner court, and then the Holy of Holies, which was the secret place on the inside of the temple that only the high priest one time a year could go and have communion with God. That's what all human beings were designed for. We were designed to have communion with God, to have relationship with God. But because of sin, God set up a specific system where only one person one time a year could actually be in his presence before Jesus came. So the priest would go in the outer court. You had this big tub full of water, and it was for ceremonial washing. You would walk up, it was called the laver. You would walk up and you would wash your hands, because the Bible was clear. God wanted clean hands and a pure heart. So they would wash their hands as an outward symbol of what they wanted on the inside. They wanted to be clean. They wanted to be pure. So they would walk up and they would wash their hands. Then they would go into the inner court. The outer court, the inner court, they would have a candle of incense. They would have a table of showbread. And they had a place where basically they would offer prayers to God. So the outer court was the washings. The inner court was where they offered incense and prayer and ate the showbread, which Jesus calls himself in John 6, the bread of life. And that's where we get that. That's why there was bread on the inside of the temple, was because it was a symbol that represented Jesus as being the bread of life. And then the candlestick represented the fact that he was the light to the world. And the incense was burned because he was the high priest who prayed for us. So the book of John is set up like that. The first six chapters are all about water. If you read the first six chapters, they have a lot of water imagery. That's the laver, that's the outer court. And then you move in chapters 7 through 18, or 7 through 17, and then you start to see prayers. Jesus actually prays. He prays in John 17 as the high priestly prayer. He prays for all his followers, and then he prays for all believers, and then he prays for those that will believe in the future. So he's offering incense. And then the final third of the Bible, chapters 18 through 21, is where Jesus actually offers himself as a sacrifice. And that's symbolic of the innermost court, or the innermost room where only the high priest could go, and blood would be shed and sprinkled on the Ark of the Covenant, which was God's presence. So the first six chapters are water. The next 10 chapters or so are the bread, the candle, and the prayers. And then the final few chapters are the actual life and sacrifice of Jesus. So the entire book is set up like a temple. And right now we're talking about one of the first chapters of the the bread of life. And Jesus makes this statement. We're going to start in verse 60 of John 6. Jesus makes this statement. And he says, you cannot have life in me. Verse 60. So then many of his disciples, when they heard this statement is unpleasant. Who can listen to it? Well, what statement did Jesus just make that made them uncomfortable? Well, let's go back. In verse 48 of John 6, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they died. Jesus is telling the Israelites the stories they would have already known, where the children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, they were in the desert for 40 years and God literally rained bread from heaven to feed them. And that's the picture of the life of Jesus. From heaven, Jesus came and gave us life on the earth. The manna from heaven, rained from heaven, that is a symbolic picture of Christ. So Jesus is saying, I'm the actual bread. God didn't want to feed you spiritually with actual physical bread. He wanted to feed you spiritually with spiritual bread, which is me. And then Jesus says something interesting. He says, I'm the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats from this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I will give for the life of the world also is my flesh. And then he says something that seemed to be quite gross. He said, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? And then Jesus goes on to say, if you won't eat of my body and drink of my blood, you have no part in me. What a weird statement it seems like Jesus is making. Is Jesus saying, if you don't eat my physical body and drink my physical blood, you will not have eternal life? No. Jesus is using a metaphor to say he is the source of all life. And later on, before Jesus dies on the cross, he has a meal, what we call communion or the Eucharist, depending on your background of church. He has a meal where he gives them bread and wine, and he says, this is my body and this is my blood. Take these as a sign that you have eternal life. So Jesus gives us these metaphors to say his life is our source of life. And they were freaked out and everybody left. And then in verse 68 and verse 69 of John 60, Jesus looks at his followers, his closest ones, including Peter, and he says, do you want to leave as well? Everybody had been grossed out by the fact that Jesus was talking about his physical flesh and his blood. And they said, this is gross. This man speaks oddities. These are so weird. Why is he telling us we have to eat his flesh and drink his blood? So everybody leaves. Just a few followers standing there. And he goes, you gonna leave too? And I love this. Philip says this. He says in verse 68 and verse 69, he said, where can we go? You have the words to life. What a profound revelation from a follower of Jesus. This is so vital for us to get. Where else can we go to find power and find life, find eternal life, and find the source of life for this world? The current time, the current place that we live. Where else are we going to go? There is no other place. Jesus is the source of all life. And so that's what John is trying to communicate to us through the whole book, and specifically in John 7. So let's pick it up there. In John 7, we start with that foundation that Jesus just made a crazy statement, what seems like, and then he expounds on it and he says, this is what I mean. I am the source of all life. You cannot have abundant life or eternal life without me. So here's where we start. In your notes, if you want to download the notes, you're welcome to do that. The outline I've put online, lakewoodchurch.com/outline, lakewoodchurch.com/outline. You're welcome to get the notes. In Isaiah chapter 55, we're going to start at the very top of the notes. In Isaiah 55, Isaiah basically gets a prophetic word from God, and he's explaining to the Israelites, to the children of Israel, who he's the prophet for. He tells them what God tells him to say. And this is what he says. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. Isaiah 55. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. Even if you don't have money, it goes on to say in this passage, even if you don't have money, come to me and you will receive. Those are powerful words, and they show up in John 7. When Jesus quotes this, and we'll see it in a minute, when Jesus quotes this, he's quoting Isaiah the prophet, and he's saying, come to me if you're thirsty, I will give you what you need to drink. And he says, come and listen to me so that you may live. Verse 3 of Isaiah 55, come to me so that you may live. In John 7, Jesus is drawing together two exoduses, the first and the second. In John chapter 7, Jesus is using imagery. When the children of Israel, way back in the book of Genesis and Exodus, were in Egypt, they had to be delivered by Moses. Many of you, even if you haven't grown up in church, you may know that name, Moses. He was the deliverer of the children of Israel from Egypt. And he delivered them as their leader, brought them into the desert out of captivity, out of slavery, into a place where they could live on their own from God. God sustained them in the desert for 40 years and then took them into the promised land. And Jesus is using this story, but not only that story, but later on, 1,000 years later, when Babylon came in and conquered the children of Israel and took them to captivity in the book of Daniel, one of the final books of the Old Testament, when the children of Israel were in captivity again, like they had been in Egypt, now they were in Babylon for 70 years, Jesus is using both of those exoduses, these pictures to show us, here's what it means to be free. Here's what it means to find life. And here's what it means to be saved. And so Jesus is using these two Exodus stories to make his point. Israel's idols had removed God's protection from Israel. They had worshiped idols, and he kept telling them, he said, I'm going to remove my hand. Babylon's going to come in. They're going to take you into captivity if you don't repent. And Israel kept doing it. They kept worshiping the gods of other pagan nations. They kept worshiping and building idols, even in the temple. And God said, all right. So in Ezekiel chapter 11, the glory of God leaves the temple of the children of Israel. It leaves the temple. And when that happens, Babylon comes in and takes Israel into captivity because God's hand had been removed. They had been disobedient and disobedient and disobedient and disobedient, and the judgment of God came, just like God had judged other nations. God judged his own people because God is a God of righteousness. And when we follow and obey and you know, through Jesus, when we put our faith in God, that's where we find safety and security. But when we run off and do our own thing, that's where we get ourselves in trouble. Jesus is using this picture. In Exodus 11, when the glory of God leaves the temple and Babylon comes in and destroys the temple and takes the children of Israel into captivity, they were weeping and lamenting. They were upset. They were sad. They were disappointed because their own sin had taken them into captivity. Later on in the book of Ezekiel, we'll see in a moment. Later on in the book of Ezekiel, the children of Israel are waiting for hundreds of years for Messiah to come and to restore their fortunes. They were waiting. They were saying, we want God to come back to us. God had left in Ezekiel 11. His glory had left. And they wanted him to come back. And so we see that as we move forward in the book, as we move forward in the book of John, we see the return through Jesus. We see the return of God to his people. In Deuteronomy, Yahweh declares that his people, after the curses, comes a promise of hope. And that's what they were looking for. They were looking for hope. And so what they would do is the children of Israel would have many festivals throughout the year. And there was one particular festival where they would celebrate God's deliverance out of Egypt and into the promised land where God would take care of them. And they lived in tents and they roamed around for 40 years in the desert. And God provided from his own hand, manna from heaven and quail and water from a rock. He provided for his people. And Israelites, Jews, would celebrate something called Sukkot, which was basically the Feast of Tabernacles. And it was an opportunity for them to celebrate what God had done. So they were celebrating this festival in John chapter 7. And that's where we pick up in John 7, where Jesus is coming to the city. He's coming to Jerusalem to come to the temple to celebrate the fact that God had done what he had done. Jesus was a Jew. He was human, but he was God in flesh as a human. So he was an Israelite who went and celebrated all the festivals just like everybody else. This Sukkot, or what we call the Festival of Booths or the Festival of Tabernacle, the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Booths, was a time when they would celebrate what God had done. And so Jesus is there and he comes to the temple. Now you have to remember, the temple was the place where heaven and earth came together. It's the place where the Israelites believed that the building, the actual temple, they believed was kind of a replica of the cosmos, of the universe. So they pictured it as a small symbol that represented all of God's creation, that they would actually have communion with God in all of his creation. But it was housed in a little building. And so when they came in, Jesus is talking in this chapter and he's using the book of Ezekiel to remind the Jews what they were waiting on. He was using it to remind the Israelites at the festival, at this festival of Sukkot or the Feast of Booths or Feast of Tabernacles, to remind them that they were waiting on God to return. He had left in Ezekiel 11 and they were in captivity, and then they came out of captivity and they were able to rebuild the temple. And there was a second temple they were now living in, but for some reason, this temple didn't feel the same. They didn't feel like God's presence was there. God had instructed the children of Israel in the book of Exodus to build the first temple, but they rebuilt the second temple and they were waiting for God to return to the temple. But he wasn't going to come back and live in a stone building. He was going to come back in flesh and live among them as a human. And so Jesus is that. What they thought God was going to do was come and fill his temple again. But he didn't. He came and he filled a human body, and he came and lived among us as humans and demonstrated the true temple. But here's what Jesus is doing in John chapter 7. He's giving a picture of Ezekiel chapter 34, 35, 36, and 37. He's using imagery in John 7 to say in Ezekiel 34, the children of Israel were looking for a new shepherd from God. In Ezekiel 35, they were looking for rescue from their enemies, which at the time was Rome. And then they were looking for God to wash away their uncleanness and their sin and to put his spirit in them. And that's Ezekiel 36. And then in Ezekiel 37, we see the dry bones. In Ezekiel chapter 37, there's dry bones that come to life, and that is the resurrection. So they were looking for God to shepherd them again. They were looking for God to defeat their enemies again. They were looking for God to wash away their uncleanness and their sin and to restore them to their fortunes. And then finally to give them the great resurrection, which would be eternal life. And this is what the new covenant is. So when Jesus uses this phrase, the new covenant, Ezekiel 36 uses it, Jeremiah chapter 31 also talks about the new covenant that God would come and he would wash away sin and he would give us a heart, a new heart and a new spirit. He said, I would put a heart of flesh where there's been a heart of stone, and I would give you a new spirit where there's been a spirit of death, there's now a spirit of life. And so this is what we call the new covenant. Now, in Genesis chapter 2, in your notes, we see a river that flows through the Garden of Eden, and it branches off into four rivers. This waterway basically brought life to the land. And in Genesis 2, we see this river bringing life. But in Scripture, when you see water, it's a picture of the Spirit, especially in the book of John. It's a picture of the Holy Spirit given to us to bring life. You see the water in Genesis 1, verse 2, hovering. Holy Spirit is there. And then you see it in Genesis chapter 2, where the rivers are flowing through the garden. And what the children of Israel were doing was they were thinking back. They were using these stories that they knew of Adam and Eve and the children of Israel in the desert. They were using these stories. When they looked at Jesus, they were saying, he's reminding us of all of these things that we've known were true, that have happened in the past, and that we're waiting on God to do again, to bring us into life, to bring us into his Spirit and his power, to shepherd us again, for his presence to come back to us where it had left from the temple. They rebuilt the temple after it was broken down and destroyed, and they were waiting on God to come back and fill that temple. And Jesus came and said, I'm no longer going to fill that temple. It's a new day. So in the book of John, I'm going to skip ahead. In the book of John, Jesus, in chapter 7, the chapter that we're in right now, in the verse 37, we're going to start there. There's this moment where Jesus actually comes to the temple at the Feast of Tabernacle, Sukkot. And they believed, the Israelites believed, when the Messiah would come, when God would return to his people, the Messiah would stand on the foundation of the temple and it would break open, and literally a watery river would come flowing out and would heal everything in Israel. It would heal the land. Even it would flow down to the Dead Sea, and it would bring life to the Dead Sea. And we find this picture in Ezekiel 47. Ezekiel 47 is a river. I don't have time to go through that whole chapter, but it's a river that brings life where Israel was dry and broken, and there were parts of Israel that were dead. They believed the Messiah would come and a new river, a physical watery river, would come and replenish the land. The land was important to the Jews. So what they saw in Genesis, they were like, God's going to do this again. He's going to come and his Spirit's going to live in the temple, and water's going to rush out, and it's going to replenish everything that's been dried and broken. He's going to bring us life again. Except this time, Jesus wasn't talking about actual water. When Jesus stood on the Temple Mount, but on the temple foundation, he stood there and he says these words in John 7, 37. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Remember, we read Isaiah 55 at the very beginning of this John chapter 7. Jesus is quoting Isaiah 55, and he says, if you're thirsty, come to me and drink. He says it right here. Whoever believes in me, verse 38, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Jesus is tying together the garden and Ezekiel 47 and the temple. And he's saying, I am the one who is bringing life through the water, but it's not physical water. They were waiting for the Messiah to come and stand in the foundation, for it to break open and water to come rushing out. And Jesus was saying, no. It's not about the physical water. It's about the spiritual water. It's about life flowing from me into you, and then out of you into others. So phrase that many of us have read probably many times. Maybe you've read this passage, maybe you've seen this, the power of God flowing through our lives, the Holy Spirit living inside of us and giving us life. This is what Jesus is quoting. He's quoting Isaiah 55, and he's using the book of Ezekiel to give the Jews imagery to say, I am the source of life that you've been waiting for. And they would have known this. They would have seen Jesus get up on the temple foundation, and they were waiting. Is the foundation going to break open? Is it going to crack open and water come rushing out? No, it didn't. From underneath the altar is what the Bible says. They were waiting for it to come from underneath the altar and come out. But Jesus said, I am the one from whom that comes. I am the one whom the Spirit comes through. I am the one who is the source of all life. I am the one who brings restoration where there's been brokenness and there's drought and where things are dead. And he said, if you come to me and drink, out of you will come rivers of living water. So we see in Ezekiel 47, where there's a river that comes and brings life to God's people. And it's using that imagery, just like Genesis 2, to bring life to everything. But Jesus wasn't talking about physical water. He was talking about his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and his power. And this is the sign of the new covenant that Jesus brought. He's not going to put this in a concrete building. He's not going to bring the life of God to us through himself and then put it inside of a building. He's going to be the temple. And the Bible actually says eventually, when the Spirit of God lives in you, you will be the temple of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You are the actual temple of God. If you, by faith, have put your faith in Jesus, you are where the Holy Spirit lives. You have power. You are a power source. Not because of you, not because of me, not because of your own power, but because of Jesus. And when Jesus conquered death, that means you and I can have life. He brought life, so you and I can have life. The Bible says in Romans 6, we died to sin and now are alive to God. And that's the beauty of this, is Jesus is saying, he's using this imagery, and they were waiting for a real river to come, like, you know, floodwaters to come rushing out and to go out of the temple down into the land. And Jesus said, no, I'm talking about the Spirit. I'm talking about the power. I'm talking about what comes from inside of you. And that's the beauty that we have, the hope that we have in Jesus, is the power of God and the Spirit of God that Jesus brought is not for a physical temple anymore. It's for us, temples of flesh. It is for us to be the place where heaven and earth come together and by which we get power and abundant life from God. And here's the beauty of this, is that it's not just for us, it's for us to give. It's for us to share. Because Jesus said, out of your belly, out of your innermost being will come rivers of living water. It's not meant to stay in you. It's not a reservoir, okay? It's not a tank, a holding tank. It is literally a place where it's a conduit. God wants heaven to come through you, the power of God to come through you. And Jesus is saying, I am the source of life, and because I'm in you, you have life to give as well. So friends, as we study this, as we understand what Jesus is communicating to us in the book of John, that he is the source of life, and so because of that, he lives in us, we have power as well. My encouragement to you is everywhere you go, you have power. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 2:14, everywhere we go, we have the fragrance of the knowledge of Christ. Everywhere we go, we have the fragrance of the knowledge of God. When people see you, they see light on your face and they go, there's something different about you. There's a peace that you have. There's a joy that you have. There's a power that you have. There's a discernment that you have of things in your life and in the world. There's a prayer life that you have. There's a worship that you have. There's a power in you that's different. And people go, why are you different? And you say, because the source of life lives on the inside of me. It's not my own power. It's not my own spirit. It's not my own ability. It's only Jesus. But Jesus made this a point to say in John 7, this was the whole chapter is about. He says, I am at the end of 6 and all of 7. I am the source of life. I am the bread of life. if you come to me and you eat and you drink, I will give you abundant life and power. Dunamis is the word in the Greek. Literally, dynamite power. That's what the Greek word means. God gives us dynamite power. And He wants us to live that power in our lives. So friends, my challenge to us tonight is, how are you living the power of God in your world? How are you communing with God, letting Him fill you? Ephesians 5:18 says that we need to be filled with the Spirit every day. Be filled. Why? Because you leak. Everywhere you go, you leak. And it's good. You should. It should overflow and come out of you. And that fragrance, that understanding of the power of God in your life, people should see that and hear that and know that. And so my encouragement to you tonight is this. As we go through John 7, you see Jesus telling us, you're going to be a conduit. You're going to be a source of life for other people, not because of your power, but because I live inside of you. So where the old temple had been, Jesus came, and He is the temple. And then He comes to live inside of us, who are His followers. We become a temple of the Holy Spirit. We become a place where the Spirit flows from us. Not a physical water, a spiritual water. And we have that life living on the inside of us. That's the beauty of this. This is the majesty and the magnificence of following Jesus, is that literally, other faith systems or other ancient pagan religions were like, man, you gotta find your way to the gods. You gotta appease them. You've gotta sacrifice the right sacrifices for them. You've gotta do all of those things. Where God says, I'm actually going to come as a human. I'm going to show you, demonstrate to you what it means to be human. And then I'm going to empower you to live the same way. What a good father. What a good father that He doesn't leave us unto ourselves. That He doesn't leave us alone to do our own thing. That He doesn't leave us to try to figure it out. He said, I'm going to actually have my Spirit flowing through you. I'm going to have power coming from you. I'm going to have fruit coming from you. Galatians 5:22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, meekness, and self-control. And God actually produces that in us. That's what rivers do. What do rivers do? They bring life. Floods, and we know that in Houston in the last 4 or 5 years, floods can damage. Rivers bring life. A river brings life to trees and to plants and to fruit. It brings life to crops. Streams and rivers bring life. And so God's river of life coming through us is what we want to live out. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, Peter, one of the very first pastors of the Church of Jesus, said this, His divine power has given us everything we need for life, a godly life, through the knowledge of Him who has called us by His own glory and goodness. Pastor Peter is actually telling us in 2 Peter 1, 3 and 4, God has given us every bit of power we need for life and godliness in Him. Everything you need to live, God has given to you. And then he says, through these, He has given us, that's His promises, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them, you may participate in the divine nature. Did you know that? As a follower of Jesus, you participate in the divine nature. Jesus lives on the inside of us. The Holy Spirit empowers us, and we actually get to commune and experience divine nature. Are we God? No. But we experience His life inside of us. This is the mystery that Paul explains to us in all of his letters in the New Testament. He explains, this is a mystery. This is a mystery, how the God of the universe comes and lives inside of His followers. This is so good. Jesus gives us this picture in John 7. So friends, if you're looking for life, it's found in Jesus. He is the source of all life. The Bible says in Colossians 1 that He actually, through Him, everything was made. By Him, for Him, and through Him, all of the universe was constructed and made and created. Jesus is the source of all life, and He's the source of all spiritual life. He gives us abundant life to live in this world. Because of the resurrection, you have life in you. Romans 8:11, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you. You have resurrection life. Because you have life, you have power everywhere you go. Because you have power, you have authority. And you bring life to those around you. And people will see the power of God in your life. So tomorrow morning, here's what I want us to do. Tomorrow morning, I want us to get up. And I want us to expect God to do something powerful through our lives for someone else. I want us to pray for it, and I want us to expect it. So tonight, as I've given you all of my notes, I didn't want to miss anything, but I wanted to show you how the puzzle of John 7 fits together. It is a puzzle, and I went pretty quickly tonight, but I want you to see in the notes, if you have a chance to download the notes. I've added some extra things in there. They were waiting. These people were waiting for the power of God to return. And Jesus brought it. And now you and I have it. And my encouragement to you is this. Live with the understanding, if you follow Jesus by faith, He has come to live inside of you. You are the power source. Not your own power, His divine power that He's given to you. And you have authority. So take that authority. Take that authority. The enemy comes to you. Take that authority. You have authority to speak the truth, the word of God, to worship in power, to pray, and to resist him. The Bible says in James 4, resist the devil and he'll flee. Resist him. Stand against the attack of the enemy. The power of God produces that in us. And let me say this, the final thing, have confidence. Have confidence when you wake up tomorrow, have confidence that the God of the universe has given you power to live. He has given you power to be an influence to those in your world, in your sphere, your friends, your coworkers. Let me tell you something, pray, and then expect God to do things tomorrow. Because you have resurrection life, you have the same spirit that lives on the inside of you, you have power and authority. And I'm telling you, we all need to take that authority and use it. We need to use it for, not on the people around us, for the people around us, for ourselves, our families, our friends. Here's a great one. There's a story. I remember years ago, a pastor in California, some ladies came to him after a church service and they said, sir, we came here because we met some of the people that are part of your mall ministry. They came to the mall and they were talking to us about Jesus and there was light and power all over their lives. And so they convinced us and influenced us to come to your church service. And the pastor looked at them and said, we don't have a mall ministry. He said, that's just our people. That's what we do. That's where I want us to live. I want us to live knowing that we have the power of God. We need to live knowing that we have the source of life living inside of us. We need to pray and expect God to move in our lives as though we have that power and authority, because we do. The final story, the same church, there was a young man, 21 years old. He was working at a supermarket. He was a cashier at a supermarket. Some people came through the line and he saw a little older woman who was sick. She didn't feel well. And he looked at her, this is years ago, and he said, ma'am, can I pray for you? And she said, yes, I would love that. So he prays for her. Immediately, she starts feeling better. Immediately, she starts feeling better. And so one of the managers who also went to the church, he goes to this church. This 21-year-old cashier goes to this particular church. And the manager that works there also went to the same church. Manager gets on the PA on the announcement over the microphone at the supermarket and says, if any of you feel sick or need prayer for anything, we have some people up here praying for you. 21 people got in his line in 10 minutes for prayer. Let me tell you, when the power of God lives inside of you, there's a boldness and a confidence that comes with that. So my prayer for all of us is that tomorrow morning when we wake up, we connect with God. If it's 5 minutes or 5 hours, we connect with God. We realize and have the confidence that the power of God lives in us and that river flows out of us, and that we'll have the confidence to love others around us with that power and authority. With that power and authority. Jesus told us, out of you will come rivers of living water. Not because of you, because of me. That's Jesus. Because of him. It's not on you. It's not on you to produce it. Don't be concerned. Don't be stressed out about trying to produce fruit and power in your life. God's already given it to you. Just walk in it. Walk in it. Receive it. It's nothing you can produce. It only can be received. So receive from him and then let it spill out to everybody around you. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you that you have given us your spirit and your power, and your authority. And Lord Jesus, we want to be good stewards of that time with you, to receive from you and then let it spill out unto others. We want to love people with your love and your power and your authority. And God, we want to help shape the world around us through that power. And so tonight, God, as we hear your word, remind us tomorrow when we wake up that we have authority and power in you and only you. You are the source of life. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you. My name is Pastor Jeremy. Thank you for watching tonight. Catch us next week as we go into the next chapter in John chapter 8. But John chapter 7 is all about Jesus being the source of life. We have power and authority, and it comes through Jesus. We love you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week, and we'll see you right back here next Monday night, 7:30, for the next chapter of John.